Hi everyone, welcome to our second lecture on developing efficient algorithms. So we'll continue basically the discussion about efficient algorithms, the Big O notation. We discussed last time basically the growth rate of an algorithm. We discussed the Big O notation, the best versus the worst times. We talked about the different complexity times, the constant complexity, similar ideas in space complexity. Then we'll talk about linear complexities, quadratic complexities, and we also had an example of cubic complexity in the quiz. Then we talked about logarithmic times. We analyzed the binary search algorithm, and then we analyzed the selection sort, which is an example of quadratic time. Basically, it's n square. We also talked about the insertion sort algorithm, and it also, the worst time complexity was n square. Now, before we continue with Towers of Hanoi and Fibonacci, let's actually talk a little bit more about this class of polynomial complexity time algorithms. So an algorithm is said to be polynomial time if its running time is upper bounded by a polynomial expression. So for instance, if the time to execute the algorithm on the size of the input n is n to the power k for some positive constant k, then this is a polynomial algorithm. And all of the examples that we saw before, except the logarithmic time complexity, was polynomial. So quadratic algorithms are polynomial, linear algorithms are polynomial. Now this concept of polynomial times, time leads to several complexity classes that you will learn more in depth in Theory of Computation, CSC 303 at Stony Brook. Basically, P is the class of all the complexity class of decision problems that can be solved on a deterministic Turing machine in polynomial time. A Turing machine is like a state machine that you have an input state, and then the edges in this state machine are labeled with basically input characters. And polynomial on a deterministic Turing machine, it means that in every state, you basically have a bunch of choices, but each choice is distinct from the other choices. A deterministic Turing machine tells you that basically you can get, given an input, a set of input characters, you start from the first state, you follow the edge to go to the next state, from that state to another state, and so on. And there is a unique, basically, path that you can basically take from the input state to an acceptance state in this algorithm. Now, non-deterministic polynomial are non-deterministic Turing machines, which basically means that in a state, you may have multiple edges, outgoing edges, labeled with the same character. So non-deterministic polynomial means that you can take an input, which is a sequence of these input characters, and follow the transitions, the paths from basically every node that you start from the input state, and then you follow the first character, but you can follow, you basically have multiple paths possible because multiple edges are labeled with the same character. If you know exactly which path to follow, it basically, you can recognize that string in polynomial time. So non-deterministic means that basically you can follow any one of the paths, and polynomial time in the size of the input says that if you know which path to follow, you can basically just match the input characters to the labels of these edges in the Turing machine, in this state machine. The problem is that although this NP, non-deterministic polynomial, can be verified quickly, if you have a solution to the problem, you can basically verify it in polynomial time, in the size of the input, you can verify this is indeed a solution to the problem. But you cannot find the solution quickly because basically there is no known way to find the solution quickly unless you prove a very hard proof equality that P is the same with NP, which is assumed not to be true. Now, in this class of problems, there are the two classes that we discussed, the P class, the polynomial decision class, and the non-deterministic polynomial class. In the non-polynomial deterministic class, non-deterministic polynomial class, it's basically a class of problems which are quite hard. And the hardest problems in this class are called NP-hard. They basically are as hard as the hardest problem in this class. A problem is said to be NP-hard if everything in NP can be transformed into it in polynomial time. So these problems, there are easy ways, polynomial ways, to transform one problem into another problem. Basically, you are looking at, we will see a couple of examples of NP complete problems, NP hard problems. Basically, there is a direct translation in polynomial time of the problem into another problem in the same set. If a problem is both NP, so basically you can check solutions in polynomial time, and NP hard, that means that it's as hard as the hardest problems in this class, is called an NP-complete problem. And there are many NP-complete problems that we'll discuss. Now, it's not known, it's not proven. If you do prove it, it's actually an amazing result. If P is the same class with NP, and it's assumed not to be true. So there are two possibilities at the current time, that P is not equal with NP, which means that P is basically the class of all problems that you can solve with a deterministic Turing machine in N time, in polynomial time. Then there is the NP hard problems, which are the hardest problem in the non-deterministic polynomial time. And basically there are the NP problems, non-deterministic polynomial, and at the NP complete class is basically the intersection of NP hard with NP. If P would be equal with NP, which is assumed to be false but is unproven yet, in that case, NP complete problems can be solved in the same time that it would take a polynomial problem. And that's highly improbable. But this is an unsolved problem that you will learn about in theory of computation. And there are many NP-complete problems that you will learn, some in this class, in fact, and some in other classes like an advanced algorithms class. The Boolean satisfiability problem, also called the set problem, you learned a little bit about it last year when you took CSC 150, Foundations of Computer Science, when you learned logic. If you are given a logic formula with propositional variables, and you want to find assignments to the propositional variables to make that formula true, it's known to be an NP-complete problem. The brute force solution for this problem is that you assign to every propositional variable true or false. But now all the possibilities that you basically can generate is 2 to the power of how many propositional variables you have there. So the brute force solution to find such an assignment of true values for your propositional variables is basically an exponential solution. It will take exponential time, 2 to the power n, to find if there is such an assignment. But it's actually in polynomial time to test it. You basically just take, if somebody gives you a solution that P is true and Q is false and R is false and T is true and so on, you can just compute the formula and it will tell you conjunction and disjunction and negation if it's true, if that is true. So checking the solution is polynomial in polynomial time in the size of how many variables you have in the input. Finding the solution with a brute force approach, it would take you exponential time. And similar other problems which can be reduced to the same problem in polynomial time. So we'll discuss about these NP-complete problems a little bit more in detail. So Boolean satisfiability problem, also called the set problem, or the propositional satisfiability problem, or satisfiability, or set, or B-set, is the problem of determining whether there is an interpretation, an assignment of true values for the propositional variables that satisfies a given Boolean formula, which is built out of Boolean variables, binary AND operator, conjunction, binary disjunction operator, negation, and parentheses. We also say that the formula is satisfiable, that's where the name is from, if it can be made true by assigning logical values to all its variables, true or false. So as I discussed, the brute force solution of assigning either true or false to every variable is that for every variable, you have top two possibilities. And then for each one of those possibilities, for the next variable, you have another two possibilities. And this is both for true and false for the first variable. And so on, it exponentially grows to every single variable. And therefore, the number of possible cases that you have to consider is 2 to the power n, where you have n propositional variables independent in the input. Other NP-complete problems, the knapsack problem. Given a set of items, each one with its weight and the value, determine the number of each items that can be included in a collection such that the total weight is less than or equal with a given limit. And the total value is as large as possible. So knapsack is an optimization problem. You have to find, let's say that you are going somewhere, you have a certain number of items, you want the maximum number of items, but in this case, you also have a cost function. The items that will give you the highest value that you can pack into basically that suitcase. The graph coloring problem is also an NP-complete problem. And the graph is basically formed out of vertices and edges that connect basically the nodes in the graph, the vertices in the graph. The question is usually, can we assign a set of labels, a label per node per vertex, subject to certain constraints? And the simplest form of this called the vertex coloring problem. The question is, can we assign colors to all the vertices such that you basically, you don't have two adjacent nodes with the same color. Now, again, it's an optimization problem. Usually the question is how many colors do we have to assign to this graph, to the vertices in this graph, so that the minimum number of colors to color the graph such that no two vertices that are adjacent neighbors to each other, they have the same color. For planar graphs, it has been proven actually using a computer that you need four colors to color all planar graphs. Planar graphs are those in which edges do not intersect. Like for instance, maps. If you have maps of countries that are monolithic, they don't have multiple parts. Hamiltonian path problem is also a graph problem where the question is there a Hamiltonian path, a path in an undirected or directed graph that connects all the vertices exactly once? And the Hamiltonian cycle problem is that, is there a Hamiltonian path that is a cycle, that you start from a node, you visit all the other nodes, and you come back to the original node? The traveling salesman problem is basically an optimization problem. In the decision version is the same with Hamiltonian cycle. Is there a Hamiltonian cycle that visits all the nodes? But in it's an optimization problem, the traveling salesman problem, that given a list of cities and the distance between each pair of cities, what is the shortest possible route that visits each city exactly once and returns to the origin. Basically, it's a salesman that wants to visit all the cities in the shortest possible path. The decision version is basically just the Hamiltonian cycle. Is there a path that visits all the cities? The optimization problem, which actually is not an NP problem because it's an optimization problem, you have to find the shortest path. So you can't even check in polynomial time if it's the shortest path. But to find the, if such a path exists is actually an NP problem. NP complete. So let's actually discuss some algorithms. So that's all about polynomial complexity. So last time actually we talked about Hanoi, Towers of Hanoi, and the question there, as you remember, was there are n disks labeled with numbers from 1 to n, and three towers, A, B, and C. And the constraints are that no disk can be on top of a smaller disk at any given time. Initially, the initial state is that all the disks are initially placed on A, the first tower. Only one disk can be moved at any given time, and it has to be put on top of another bigger disk on another tower. And the problem was that how do we move all the disks from A to B with the help of the adjacency, the auxiliary tower C. And here is a solution. We move disk one from A to B, then we move disk two from A to C. We move disk one from B to C. So basically we moved two disks from the initial tower A to the tower C with the help of B. Then we move the bottom disk three to B. And then we can basically move the other two disks from C to B using the tower A as a helper. So we move the disk one from C to A, then we move the disk two from C to B, and the disk one from A to B. And we can use the same idea for basically decomposing the problem of moving n disks from A to B by moving n minus one disks from A to C, then moving the base from A to B, then moving the n minus one disks from C to B using the tower A as a helper tower. So the solution to write it in any programming language is quite simple. Moving n disks is done recursively. You call the same function to move n minus one disks from A to C using the helper tower B. Then you move the last disk, which is just one step, from A to B. Then you move n minus one disks from C to B using the tower A as a helper. And the implementation in Java is quite simple. Basically, we read the number of disks and then we invoke the move disk n from A to B using the tower C as a helper tower. And that recursively, basically, there is a base case. If n is one, then you print the last step, move the disk n from the from tower to the to tower. Else, you move n minus one disks from the from tower to the auxiliary tower using the to tower as a helper tower. Then you state that you move the nth disk from the from tower to the to tower. And then you move n minus one disks from the auxiliary tower to the to tower using the from tower as a helper. However, if you analyze the complexity of this algorithm, it's quite expensive. So basically, we break the recurrence relation and we write it exactly as it is. If to move n disks from A to B using C, you would have to move n minus one disks from A to C using B, then move the nth disk just one step from A to B, then move again n minus one disk from C to B using the tower A. And that would say that basically the time to move n disks is the time to move n minus one disks plus one plus the time to move n minus one disks, which is two times the time to move n minus one disks plus one. And if you apply the same formula again and again and again, you will see that basically up to T of one, you execute this exactly two n minus one times. So it's two n minus one times T of one, which will just be one in fact, plus two n minus two, two to the power n minus two, plus and so on up to one. But here we have a geometric series. It's two to the power n minus one plus two to the power n minus two plus up to two plus one, which is two to the power n minus one, which in the big O notation, after ignoring non-dominating terms, is two to the power n. This is what is called exponential time. Basically, it's a two to the power n. It's very steep growth. If you look at, I will show you in a second, the growth of an exponential function, as we depart on the x-axis, the y-axis grows much faster than the x-axis. So it's a very bad in general time to have for an algorithm. So as the size increases, the time grows exponentially. So basically, if you look at the Towers of Hanoi problems, and let's say that we move one disk per second, exponential time 2 to the power 32 for 32 disks would be 2 to the power 32 divided by 365 days in a year, 24 hours, 60 minutes, and 60 seconds. It would take about 136 years to move 32 disks. And to move 64 disks, it will take about 585 billion years. Okay. Any questions up to now? So although it's easy to write, it's actually a quite complex algorithm in time complexity. Let's see if there are any questions in the chat. Not up to now. You can still hear me. Is there any problems? Okay, thank you very much, Samir. Just making sure that no one else is on Google Meet. I will close it at this time and continue the lecture. So what we saw is that based on that recurrence relation, we can immediately see some patterns. So for binary search, remember that after the first step, you discard half of the array. Then after the next step, you discard a quarter of the array, and so on. Basically, the recurrence relation is that the time to solve for an input of size n is equal with the time to solve for an input of size n divided by 2 plus a constant. And this basically recurrence relation is same with basically the fact that this is the big O notation for logarithm base 2 of n, or logarithm any base. So this is what we call logarithmic time. Then we have a linear time, basically the time to solve the input for an input of size n is the time to solve the input for an input of size n minus 1 plus constant. This was the example of linear search. You are looking at the first element. If it's not, you look at the next element. If it's not, you look at the next element, and so on. So linear search will basically give you a big O notation, a growth rate of n. And that's linear time is one of the polynomial time complexity times. It doesn't matter if you multiply with 2. So basically the time to solve for an input of size n is 2 times the time to solve for an input of size n divided by 2 plus a constant. If you expand this up to basically when you get the time to solve for 1, it's just n. So basically this, because 2 simplifies to n divided by 2, so it's basically, it will boil down to just n. But if the unit operation, like in the example of merge sort, we will see it next class. The time to solve for an input of size n is 2 times the time to solve for n divided by 2, plus the time to merge the two sorted inputs, the two sorted half inputs. That will basically, the recurrence relation in that case is n log n, is log linear time. If the time to do the middle operation is n log n, then basically you have n log to the power 2 of n. And that those are other algorithms that basically require in the middle some sort. This usually n log n is the time of sorting something. The time to solve for an input of time of size n is equal with the time to solve for n minus 1 plus O of n is basically the time of selection sort. Basically we insert the first element in the sorted order, or basically we find the maximum and we swap it with the element at the current position. But basically, we have to continue now with the rest of the elements of the array. So this was the recurrence relation that we got for selection sort last class and also insertion sort. And you see that is a quadratic time, is On square in the end. Now this is the Tower of Hanoi that we saw just now. The time to execute the Tower of Hanoi for n disks is 2 multiplied with the time to execute the Towers of Hanoi for n minus 1 disks plus O of 1. And that was the Towers of Hanoi problem, and that's the big O notation for 2 to the power n. We will see that Fibonacci also it's identical. Basically, the time to solve for n is the time to solve for n minus 1 plus the time to solve for n minus 2. So very close values for t of n minus 1, the previous case. And then we do the sum, so plus O of 1. And that also will prove that is 2 to the power n is exponential time to execute. And just to see a couple of growth rates, if you basically have an input of size 25, the constant time will take you constant time 1. For an input of 50, constant time will take you also 1 because it's constant time. The growth rate f of 50 divided by f of 25, basically 1 divided by 1, is just 1. Logarithmic time doesn't grow that much. If you double the size of the input, you see that basically logarithm in base 2, in this case of 25, is about 4.64. Logarithm base 2 of 50 is 5.64. And this value divided by this value is 1.2. So when you double the size of the input, the time doesn't double. It's basically 20%, about 20% more. For linear time, basically an input of 25 would take you 25, an input of 50 would take you 50. So the time just doubles. If you double the size of the input, it doubles the time to execute the algorithm. Log linear time, n log n. So for an input of size 25, log of n is 4.64 multiplied with 25 is 116 approximately. And then basically the same n log n for 50 would be 282. And we can see that the time when you double the size of the input basically doubles and a little bit more. So it's 2.43, it's about 40% over double. For quadratic n square, basically when you double the size of the input, it quadruples the time that it takes to execute it. So 25 square is 625, 50 square is 2500. And if you divide 2500 by 625 is 4 times more time to basically execute the program for double the size. Cubic time, it will be 8 times more time to solve the problem. So 25 cube is 15,625. 50 cube is 125,000. And if you divide 125,000 by 15,625, it's 8 times bigger. Exponential time is much bigger. So 2 to the power 25 is quite large, is 3.36 multiplied with 10 to the power 7. 2 to the power 50 is about 10 to the power 15 multiplied with 1.27. And if you divide this number by this number, is about 10 to the power 7. So exponential time really grows fast. Basically, when you grow the input, the exponential time grows much faster. And these are just basically in Cartesian plane, those specific lines. So O of 1 is constant, meaning that no matter what's the size of the input, it will take you constant time to execute the algorithm. Like for instance, getting an element from an array, no matter what's the index, you can get it in linear time because it's just an arithmetical operation. Log n is a little bit less steep, off n is linear, so as you grow the input, it grows the output with the same steep log linear, and log n is bigger than linear, and quadratic time n square is basically this graph, also bigger than linear, and exponential is the worst. Basically, the as you grow the input, exponentially it grows the time to execute that algorithm. So let's take a look at Fibonacci. I mentioned that if you look at the recurrence relation, go ahead.
Can you go back to the slide with the graph?
Yep. It's so quite to scale. So if you are looking at O of n, it should be kind of on the diagonal, but it's a little bit lower. So
okay. My question was just like for the n log n and the n squared, it seems like n squared is sometimes better. Like maybe the graph is just wrong, but is n squared like better for like some range of n, because it's higher for n log n in some of the region, or is that just the graph?
Oh, it's always n squared is always higher than n log n. I mean, it's always there is this region that you're completely right. The graph is not perfect. Basically, for okay. small values of n, yes, but that's really less than one. So after that, n squared is much bigger.
Gotcha. Thanks.
So the graph is not perfect. I'm blaming the textbook because I took it from the textbook.
Okay.
Okay. So let's analyze Fibonacci. So this is the standard Fibonacci function. It starts with Fibonacci of 0 is 0, Fibonacci of 1 is 1, and then the recurrence relation for Fibonacci, that Fibonacci of an index is Fibonacci of index minus 1 plus Fibonacci of that index minus 2. And as you grow, you can see that for 2, it will be 0 plus 1, which basically is 1. For 3, it will be 1 plus 1 is 2. And then you can see the recurrence relation. You add the previous two numbers to give you the next number. So 1 plus 2 is 3. 3 plus 2 is 5. 3 plus 5 is 8, and so on. So the implementation is quite simple. And most of you already wrote this last semester. It's basically if the index is equal with 0 or 1, you have one of the base cases. And then you have the recursive relation, that Fibonacci of n of index for any index that is zero, not zero or one, is Fibonacci of index minus one plus Fibonacci of index minus two. And if you run it, and actually I have it in Eclipse, so here is Towers of Hanoi, and I just will run it for, let's say, 10 disks is already quite big. It's 2 to the power 10 number of moves. So quite a lot of moves. For Fibonacci, again, we are going to run it for, let's say, an index 10. It will give us the value of Fibonacci 55. If you want to see the number of steps that Fibonacci will basically execute, I added the static variable steps. And then every time the function is called, it will increment the steps. So you can see that if I pass, for instance, 10. 10 will call Fibonacci of 9 and Fibonacci of 8. Fibonacci of 9 calls again Fibonacci of 8 and Fibonacci of 7, and so on. So for 10, the number of steps is 177. And if you increase that number, so let's say that I put 20, it will take me 21,000. So you can already see that it is an exponential function. The number of operations that you have to execute grows much faster than the number of in the input. So for doubling the size of the input, we basically executed about 218 times more number of steps. So quite a lot number of steps. But basically, I have a way to compute, approximate that. So let's say that T of n is the time to the complexity of Fibonacci of n. Now, T of n is T of n minus 1 plus T of n minus 2 plus a constant time. We can replace that constant with 1. And if you continue to break this, t of n minus 1 would be t of n minus 2 plus t of n minus 3 plus a constant time plus t of n minus 2 plus the constant time. But now, if you look at this, this is bigger than 2 times t of n minus 2 plus 2 constant time, because basically here we have t of n minus 2, t of n minus 2 plus the two constants plus an additional t of n minus 3. So basically what we can see here is that t of n is greater than equal with 2 times t of n minus 2. And we can apply the same inequality for t of n minus 2 versus t of n minus 4. So t of n minus 2 is also greater than equal with 2 times t of n minus 4 plus 2c. And this basically is enclosed within 2 multiplied with that value plus 2c. And you can apply this as many times as basically you can up to 1. So basically n divided by 2 times, because for every 2 steps you are going to apply this formula, you basically will apply this formula. So after n divided by 2 times, you have 2 to the power n minus divided by 2 multiplied with t of 1 plus 2 to the power n divided by 2 multiplied with a constant c plus and so on. It's a geometric series. It's going to be 2 to the power 3 multiplied with c plus 2 to the power 2 multiplied with c plus 2 multiplied with c. So basically t of n will be greater than 2 to the power n minus n divided by 2 multiplied with c plus 2 to the power n divided by 2 multiplied with c plus and so on up to 2 to the power c, 2 multiplied with c. And this is a geometric series. Is basically will if we only look at the first two, is 2 to the power n divided by 2 multiplied with c. But now you can eliminate the multiplicative, the non-dominating terms and the multiplicative constants. And you're getting that this is an exponential big O notation, a growth rate of 2 to the power n. In a similar way, if you are basically taking t of n is equal with t of n minus 1 plus t of n minus 2 plus c, t of n minus 2 is smaller than t of n minus 1, because t of n minus 1 is t of n minus 2 plus t of n minus 3, which is all positive values. So this is t of n is also less than equal with 2 times t of n minus 1 plus the constant c. And now again, you can apply the same formula. If t of n is less than 2 times t of n minus 1 plus c, then t of n minus 1 will be less than 2 t of n minus 2 plus c. And again, now you apply it n times, and you're getting that this must be t of n must be less than 2 to the power n minus 1 multiplied with t of 1 plus 2 to the power n minus 1 plus 2 to the power n minus 2 and so on, 2 to the power n minus 2 plus 2 to the power n minus 3 up to 1 multiplied with c. But again, after you get rid of the constants and the multiplicative non-dominating terms, you're basically getting that this is 2 to the power n. So the complexity of Fibonacci numbers is greater than equal with O of 2 to the power n and less than equal with O of 2 to the power n. So therefore, Fibonacci recursive takes 2 to the power n. So this algorithm is again not efficient, but is there an efficient version of Fibonacci numbers? And the answer to that is yes, very easily. You can start from the beginning, keep two variables that keep the two Fibonacci numbers, and you assign the sum of them to the third variable, and then move the pointers. Basically, the two variables that you looked at, one is equal with the previous second variable, and the second variable equal with the third variable, with the new Fibonacci index. And you just go with this sliding window of two elements up to the end, and you didn't need to do anything exponential. So if you look at this algorithm, this is an implementation of that. F of 0 is assigned 0, F of 1 is assigned 1, and F of 2 is assigned 1. And then for the index n, if n is equal with 0 or 1 or 2, you have the base cases. Otherwise, you have a for loop. in which you assign to f of 0 the value of f of 1, to f of 1 the value of f of 2, and to f of 2 the value of f of 1 plus f of 0. And you iterate up to the index n that you want it to compute. And the complexity of this algorithm, because we only have a one for loop that iterates for n minus three steps, is O of n. Any questions about Fibonacci non-recursive? And you can easily basically test it. You basically, you're sliding these two variables over the values of Fibonacci numbers n times, and you are basically getting in size of n the element at index that index.
So is there ever a reason to do the Fibonacci that's recursive? Because isn't that, that's more time intensive and more space intensive. So like, is that just like not an efficient, like, is there any reason to ever do it like that?
No. Okay. But it was a good way to learn it. And actually there are, so Fibonacci is an easy recursive function that you can easily basically linearize it. But there are like Ackermann function and McCarthy 91, which you cannot find. There are non-primitive recursive functions. You cannot find a recursive algorithm, a non-recursive algorithm, without having an exponential size of the stack to actually compute the value of that function. Okay. So if you remember last semester, we had Ackermann function in the slides for recursion. There is no algorithm like this that you can do for Ackermann. So, but in, regarding Fibonacci, there is no reason to do the recursive version anymore. You should always do this standard non-recursive version. And just to show you Fibonacci of 3, which is the version with iteration, if even if you enter, let's say, 1,000, it takes 1,001 steps. So it didn't take you a lot of time to compute it. It was quite straightforward. There is another version of Fibonacci that we'll discuss later, which is basically instead of having two variables, we are going to have an array of variables and we just take the value from that array. We discussed this one last semester again in our class. Okay, but before we discuss that solution, basically we will discuss more about the algorithm design. And algorithm design is really the process to solve a problem. So you are given a problem and you have to develop a computing model of that program. Then you recognize a certain algorithm and you now basically design that algorithm that solves that problem. Usually we are given, we know a set of patterns that we have to look for. One is to save results, which is called dynamic programming. One is to try to divide the problem into smaller instances of that problem, which is really basically divide and conquer. Divide the problem into smaller instances, solve those, merge them, and now you basically have a solution for the entire problem. Or backtracking, you have to find, let's say, how to place n queens on a chessboard. You try to place the first queen in the first corner and then place the other queen such that they don't attack the first queen, but you will at some point realize that you cannot place the rest of the queens. So you have to backtrack and move the first queen in the next cell and so on. So this is an example of another pattern that we will learn, backtracking. And so on, we will learn different patterns for different problems and how to recognize these patterns and use them. Then we have to check the correctness of the algorithm. This is usually done theoretically. We try to basically see the recurrence relation, check if it's a correct recurrence relation that solves that problem. We analyze the algorithm therefore and find its complexity. We implement the algorithm, we test the program, debug it, and then we prepare it for shipping documentation. And this is similar to what is called the waterfall model in software engineering. You basically have to follow a set of steps, requirement analysis, design and so on to solve the problem. But the goal that we have in this class is to find algorithmic techniques, or what they are called, algorithmic design patterns, ways to solve problems and recognize them in problems. So the first way is really the brute force or exhaustive search. Like, for instance, if I give you the Boolean satisfiability problem that we discussed earlier, the naive method is trying every possible solution to see which is best. Basically, start with each variable true, then one of the variables is false, then two of the variables says false, and you have n options for every one of them. That's brute force. You can implement them either with recursion or with loops, but it's really brute force search. Divide and conquer is basically the recursion idea, that you reduce the instance of the problem to a smaller one, and usually the same problem recursively, and then you iterate until you find the smallest problem that you can, is the base case, and you basically solve that problem, and then you have to merge the solutions of the smaller problems. One of the best examples of divide and conquer is merge sorting that we'll discuss next class. And the idea is quite simple. You divide the data, the array, into two halves. You sort them. Then the conquer phase is merging the sorted, but if you have two sorted arrays, you only have to compare the first elements in the sorted array, choose the minimum, advance with one index in one of the arrays, the one that contained the minimum, and again compare the first two elements. So this merge part at the end is in the size of the array. So, and you do these steps at every level also through divide and conquer. So when you have half of the array, you divide it into quarters, you sort them recursively, and then you merge them. And we will see that it basically gives you a better time than selection sort and insertion sort. Dynamic programming. It's similar to divide and conquer, but some of the sub problems will be called many different times. So basically want to avoid recomputations, and therefore you don't recompute. You just use the solution that you found in the previous, in one of the previous steps. So it's really divide and conquer, with the addition that you save the solutions for those inputs that you already know, you already computed. So the sub problems overlap, and you basically try to remember the solutions. The dynamic programming is also called caching or memoization or tabling, and non-recursive Fibonacci is an example of dynamic programming. You basically, in this example that I've wrote here, you save the results in a variable f. So f is an array of long values. Then we have, if f is already known, if f of some index is already known is different than zero, you just return that solution. So this is, these two lines is really the entire idea of dynamic programming. If you call a function, but you already know the value that is returned by that function, you return the value. You don't need to recompute it. That's what tabling or dynamic programming does. Greedy algorithms. So usually greedy algorithms are used for problems that are asking for an optimal of some problem. So for instance, the traveling salesman problem that I told you about earlier is that you have to visit some cities in the shortest possible path. A greedy heuristic for that is that at each step, visit the nearest unvisited city. So basically it doesn't guarantee that you will get a global optimum, and in fact, without backtracking, it doesn't guarantee that you are not getting into a corner and now you can't go further because you basically don't have unvisited cities that are neighbors at that location. So the intention of greedy algorithms is not to find the best solution, but to terminate in a reasonable number of steps. So basically it solves a problem in an unoptimal way, but it gives you a solution. And that's basically the idea of greedy algorithms. Backtracking, the idea is that you incrementally look for a solution, but when you get stuck in a sub-problem that cannot be solved, you backtrack. You basically, you will see it in the case of Anquin's problem. You go to the previous option and you try another path. You try another position. So let's start in order in these different types of problems. So dynamic programming. We had that example of Fibonacci in which we had an array of long values f, and then the Fibonacci function with checks. If the index is 0 or 1, the base case, it just returns those values. Otherwise, it looks at the global static variable f, and if f of that index is different than 0, it returns the value. So the idea of dynamic programming is that do not recompute, because you already computed this once, return the value. And this is the entire program. So basically the Fibonacci algorithm uses the same problems multiple times. So f of n minus 2 is used not only for f of n, but also for f of n minus 1. So first of all, it's a recursive solution. Fibonacci is defined recursively. However, if you just use recursion, the subproblems overlap, and we saw the complexity is exponential. So we have to recognize the dynamic programming part, that some problems are used in many different places, and exponentially it grows. Like f of 1 is used now not only in computing f of 2 on one path, but in recomputing f of 2 in many different locations in this tree. And instead of recomputing, we solve each sum problems once and store the results. So next time we call the function with the same index, we just return the result. And it basically, we get a linear time for finding the solution. And again, I can put steps here. So static. And every time that we call the function, actually every time that we call the function and we compute it, so only here on the else part, I will, before return, I will increment the steps. So now if we are passing in and we print out, let's print it here, system. Steps. And we are printing the number of steps. We'll see that if we enter 10, it basically does 9 steps or 10 steps, because we ignored that I already included once f of 1. So the number of times that we execute the inner function, which is just linear, there are no for loops there, is exactly equal with the input size. So we are not recomputing too much. We are computing exactly in linear time. So that's dynamic programming. And this is very useful in a lot of algorithms, like for instance, substrings that we will do a little bit later to find a substring in a bigger string. Dynamic programming is one of the best methods. Now, another algorithm that we'll discuss is the greatest common divider. And the greatest common divider is basically the greatest integer that divides both of the inputs. So it's a method that takes two inputs, m and n. And we want to find the greatest integer that it's a divisor both of m and n. And the standard brute force algorithm is that we start with the greatest common divider equal with 1. And then we have a loop, which looks for every k starting with 2. As long as k is less than equal with m and less than equal with n. And if m divides k, m modulo k is equal with 0, and n divides k, n modulo k is also equal with 0, then the greatest common divisor is k. And we return the greatest common divisor. The complexity of this algorithm is of n. In the worst case complexity, we iterate up to the minimum between m and n, and none of them is a no k is the divisor of both. Therefore, GCD will be returned 1, and that's exactly n steps, whatever minimum between m and n. And if you basically execute this algorithm, that's exactly, you find the greatest common divisor. And in the worst case, as I said, it will be the minimum between the two. And let me show you an example. So GCD, this was the standard one. And I'm entering, let's say, 41 and 42. And the greatest common divisor is 1. If you look at the number of steps, so let's define, actually I can define it as a local variable, integer steps equal to 0, and we increment steps in this function, steps plus plus, and we execute this function for 41 and 42. It basically, actually I should have printed the number of steps. It's going to be n, O of n. It's basically n minus 1. So 42 and 42 and 40, 2 and 41 are basically, it will take us 40 steps. So in the worst case is n, the price of this algorithm. Now, the first way to improve this is basically start backwards. So consider that one of them, like n, is the bigger one, and now you the smaller one, and now you iterate from k equal n up to 1, and if m modulo k is equal with 0 and n modulo k is equal with 0, then the GCD will be set and you break the loop. And again, in the worst case, it will take n steps from n to 1, so exactly the same algorithm as before. It will take you exactly the same. There is no basically better way to compute this. So basically you also take linear time. Now, the third version is that you should actually not go from n, you should go from n divided by 2. Because if you already checked if m is equal with n, you return m. And now you iterate from n divided by 2 up to 1. And again, you compute the modulo, but now the worst time is n divided by 2. And after you take the non-dominating constants out, your time is still linear. The growth rate is still linear. So basically you don't get anything out of this extra. A more efficient algorithm for GCD was actually discovered by Euclid around for 300 BC. And the idea stands the following, that the algorithm is that the greatest common divisor between m and n is, if m modulo n is 0, then n is the divisor between m and n. Otherwise, the greatest common divisor between m and n is the greatest common divisor between n and m modulo n. And how do we get this? Why is this true, that the remainder is also divisible by the same greatest common divisor as the original m and n? If you divide m by n, you get m is equal with n multiplied with a quotient, with an integer, plus a remainder. So this is the unique factorization theorem. It's the unique remainder theorem, quotient remainder theorem, and you basically get that m divided by n, no matter what m and n is, gives you a quotient and a remainder. And the remainder is between 0 and n, minus 1 included. If p, the greatest common divisor, was a divisor of both m and n, then you basically, you can divide by p this equation and you get an integer is equal with an integer n divided by p multiplied with k, plus r divided by p. But if m divided by p is an integer and n divided by p is an integer, the only way that an integer can be equal with the sum here is if r divided by p is also an integer. Therefore, it follows that if you pass N and M in the greatest common divisor, you should also have the same greatest common divisor that it divides P, it divides N and R. So basically, the same greatest common divisor between M and N is the greatest common divisor between the smaller O1, N, and the remainder of M modulo N. Now, this is easily implemented, and we will show that the time complexity for this algorithm is log in base 2 of N. So this is my fourth GCD. And if we run it and we pass 41 and 42, it will also compute the greatest common divisor. But if I want to see the number of steps, static integer steps, and we increment the number of steps in this function before we execute it, steps plus plus, and we are going to print the number of steps, we can basically see that it will give us in three steps that the greatest common divisor is one, okay? So it was actually, because we divided 42 by 41, we got the remainder one, and now we ask what's the GCD of 41 and one, and we divided 41 with one and we get the remainder zero, and we return one. So in three steps, you return the result. But no matter what you are passing as an input, the number of steps that this algorithm will take is log of the minimum of the two numbers. And how is this complexity obtained? So remember that there are two cases in the for loop, basically in this method. There is the base case, which takes a time of one, and then there is the recursive case in which for an M and an N, we are calling the GCD for N and M modulo N. Okay, so assume that one of them is bigger. So we basically have one bigger and one smaller. M is greater than or equal with N. Now we can show that the remainder is less than M divided by N. And how? Basically, there are two possibilities. N is less than half of M, and N is greater than half of M. In the first case, if N is less than half of M, M modulo N will be less than half of M, because basically we divide a bigger number by N, N is less than half of the bigger number, the remainder must be still less than half of the greater number. If N is greater than half of M, then M modulo N is going to be M minus N, which again, the difference, if now N is greater than half of M, the difference between M and N must be less than half of M. So no matter if N is less than half of M or greater than half of M, the remainder is always less than half of M. That's the remainder of that division. Now the GCD, when you pass in M and an N integers, it calls GCD of N and M modulo N. But M modulo N is less than half of the original M. So it's exactly like in the case that we basically looked at binary search and half of the array was discarded. In this case, half of the input is discarded because the remainder, one of the arguments now that you're getting is half of what the original argument was. So at every step, GCD basically reduces by half the problem. And that's why the complexity reduces to logarithmic complexity, because no matter what's the sum of M and N originally, at every step out of the bigger one, half, at least half is gone. Okay. And we converge faster to one. So that's basically the idea that the brute force will test all the possible divisors up to the greatest one, actually up to the end, and then take the greatest one as the greatest common divisor. the checking half of the possible results or coming from top to the bigger number to one and breaking when you find the divisor would also take as growth rate n in the worst case. Euclidean algorithm takes logarithmic time, log of n. So this is in some respects also an example of divide and conquer. You divide the problem into smaller problems recursively, and you basically find a solution for the bigger problem. Another example that we will actually discuss about is finding prime numbers. Prime numbers are one of the most important issues in number theory that is used in computer science. And we say, if you remember from CSC 150, Foundations of Computer Science, a prime number is an integer greater than one, that its only possible divisors, positive divisors, are one and itself. And there are prizes to find big prime numbers, like the first that discovers a prime number with at least 100 million decimal digits, there is a prize of 150,000 to find that. We will try to compare different versions of the algorithm to find prime numbers. One is the brute force algorithm. Basically, for any number, you test all of the previous number, the smaller integers up to one, not included, to see if they divide the number n. And brute force is basically quite expensive, is in the size of n for one number to find that it's prime. If you want all the numbers up to some value that are prime, then you will basically get a quadratic algorithm in the case of brute force. An improvement of that will be to choose all of the divisors up to square root of that number, and then we'll choose all the possible prime numbers up to square root of that number. And we are getting better the algorithms. So we start with the first algorithm. Basically this, if I want to find all the prime numbers less than n, n being a number that the user enters, then it will be a while loop that iterates up to n, as long as number is less than equal with n. We set a flag variable is prime to true, this is a prime number, then a for loop that iterates from 2 to the square root of that number. And if the number divides modulo the divisor is equal with 0, then it's a prime number. Then it's not a prime number, it has a divisor different than 2, different than 1 and itself. And is prime is set to false. We break the loop and we basically, if it's still prime, we put it in an array or we print it. So basically this is how the program, the whole program looks. And you enter an upper limit. So for instance, I want all the prime numbers up to 100 and it gives me all the prime numbers. It iterates one by one to 100 for each one of them. It iterates from 2 to that number to find if it's if it has any divisor. So the prime numbers up to 100 are 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, 19, and so on. One thing that you can see here is that they are evenly distributed. So in fact, there is no highest prime number. We can actually, I proved it in CSC 215, the equivalent of 150 several times. There are 25 numbers equally distributed around 100 that are prime numbers and they are still growing. So this brute force can be improved a little bit. So first of all, the brute force, if you look at the complexity, is basically quadratic for every number. So n is input once, and then for every number up to the square root of the number, you look at every single smaller number to see if it's a divisor. Now, there are small improvements that we can do. We can iterate up to the square root of that number. We don't have to iterate up to that number. A good compiler will not compute the square root at every step. It will basically compute the square root once and then for a loop that iterates from 2 to the square root. Also, it doesn't have to compute the square root. So square root is quite heavy to implement. So a better way is to basically for all the numbers between 36 and 48, you know that square root is 6. So basically, at every step, you look at the square root of the next increment number. So our for loop that we had in the middle is that the square root is less than the square root multiplied with the square root as long as it's less than the number. If it's less than the number, we increment the square root. So it's only an if statement. And now we go up to the square root. We never have to compute the square root. We started with square root is 1. And then if the square of that is less than number, we increment the square root. And we only have to do it once in a while. So as the squares are getting further from each other, we'll basically have to compute it less and less. Since it takes square root of I times to check if a number is prime, then the algorithm to compute all the prime numbers up to n would take square root of 2 plus square root of 3 plus square root of 4 up to square root of n. But this is less than n times the square root of n. So in fact, basically this, the time complexity for this algorithm is n square root of n, okay? So it's a little bit of improvement. We don't have now a quadratic algorithm, we have a log linear algorithm. Actually, it's better than log linear algorithm. So the way that we implemented that and every number is that when we want to prove that I is not prime, and we had that for loop that goes down and tries to find the numbers that are basically divisors of I, for any number I, if it's not a prime, then there means that there exists a prime number that is the lowest prime number, P, such that multiply with another integer Q is equal with I. That shows that I is not prime. And P must be less than Q. In best would be to find the smallest prime number that divides I. That's when that break will basically break so we can get out of the loop if it's not a prime number. So this is when that break fires, when we find the smallest prime number P such that I is equal with P multiplied with an integer. Now, there is a function which gives you pi of I that gives you the number of prime numbers less than I. And they are relatively uniformly distributed. So if we are to find the prime number that is a divisor of this number I that we are looking if it's prime, we have to look for those numbers. So the number of prime numbers up to 2 is 1, the prime numbers up to 3 is 2, the prime numbers up to 6 is 3, up to 20 is 8. And it has been proven that this number of prime numbers up to a value I is I divided by with log of I. Moreover, it's actually also shown that is actually less than square root of I divided by log of I, okay? And they are uniformly distributed. What this tells us, in fact, and I may actually have a slide hidden here. Let me actually unhide it. Good. What this shows us, and if we actually look, is that the complexity of that algorithm that we saw before to find all of the prime numbers of up to n is actually much better than that. It's not n square root of n, but we are in each case, we are actually stopping with this break at the first prime number that is a divisor of the number that we are looking at number. So really is not, and prime numbers are relatively uniformly distributed, which means that we are not looking at all the square root of that number, like 2 or 3 or 4. We are looking at less numbers than that before we hit the break. So it's actually 2 square root of 2 divided by log of 2 plus 2 square root of 3 divided by log of 3 and so on up to 2 square root of n divided by log of n. And since all of these are less than square root of n divided by log of n, this whole formula will be basically less then 2 multiplied with n times square root of n divided by log of n. So the complexity of this algorithm is actually better than n log n, is n square root of n divided by log of n. But the algorithm is quite complicated. So the way that we implemented it with this variable that increments the square root, and that we are actually analyzing the complexity of this algorithm, is quite complicated. There is an easier way to compute, again, a way that was developed 200 years BC compute, to find all the prime numbers less than a variable, than a number n. And the algorithm called the sieve of Eratosthenes is that you first define an array primes of n Boolean values. So you have an input n of basically the largest number, and you want to find all the prime numbers for up to n. Initially, all the values will be set to true. Then you start with looking at the array from the beginning, and for the first value in that array that is true, you declare this is a prime number, and then every other multiple of that number is not a prime number. So the moment that we see that 2 is a prime number, 2 multiplied with 2, 2 multiplied with 3, 2 multiplied with 4, and so on up to 2 multiplied with k such that k is less than n, is going to be marked as not being a prime number. So we iterate n divided by 2 times to mark all of the multiples of 2 as not being prime. Then we continue with our array. So basically the next value in the array, we increment with 1 the index. The next value that is true is a prime number. So 3 is a prime number. And now we are marking all the multiples of 3 with false. So 6, 9, 12, and so on. So we iterate n divided by 3 times. We basically in a for loop that iterates increments with 3 at every step, we iterate over the elements, and if they are not already false, I make them false. And then I continue in this array. So now 4 was not a prime number. I go to the next one that is true. So basically that is 5. And then for every multiple of 5, I mark it as a prime number. And I continue this algorithm basically like this. In a for loop, first I read the number of n that I want to pass as integer, the number of upper limit for prime numbers. I define my array of n plus 1 prime numbers. I mark all of them with true by default. Then I iterate from k equal to up to n divided by k. If primes of k is true, then basically for all the integers from k to n divided by k, prime of k multiplied with I is assigned false. So we have the inner loop that basically assigns with false to all the multiples of the current number that is prime. And then we basically just continue. I take the next element that is true in that array starting from the beginning. So I don't have to test for primary anymore at all. I just iterate to that array and find the next one that has true. And I say this must be primary, because if it would have been false, it should have been, it couldn't have been false, because it would have been marked by all of the previous numbers that could have been multiple of. So the smart thing about the sieve of Eratosthenes is that you don't need to test for prime numbers. You just iterate through an array, and the moment that you find the prime number, you declare all of the other multiples of that prime number as not being prime. And that's it. So the same algorithm without having to do the complicated algorithm to find prime numbers, but actually finds all the prime numbers. And let me show you the sieve of Eratosthenes in action. So if I pass in, let's say, 100, it will give me the prime numbers up to 100. And if I would have measured the time between the two algorithms, the brute force one and the sieve of Eratosthenes, I would have seen that sieve of Eratosthenes has the same complexity, n square root of n divided by log of n. And the way to compute it is actually quite simple. So for every prime number, as I iterate through the numbers to find the prime number, I have to mark n divided by k as not being prime. N divided by k minus k plus 1, because you don't have to iterate over the previous ones. So it's from the rest of them minus k plus 1. And this basically will have this recurrence relation, which tells me that the time to find all the prime numbers is n divided by 2 plus n divided by 3 plus n divided by 5 and so on. How many terms I have here is exactly the number of prime numbers that I have in pi of n, which we saw before that was square root of n divided by log of n. So the entire complexity of this is n multiplied with square root of n divided by log of n. Even this upper bound is very loose. The complexity time is actually much smaller than this. So the sieve of Eratosthenes is a good method as long as you can fit the matrix, the array n basically in memory. And you don't have to test for prime. So here are the different algorithms that we saw. The brute force approach to find all the possible divisors of every number is quadratic. Checking the divisors up to square root of n is n square root of n. Checking the prime numbers up to square root of n is n square root of n divided by log of n. And that's the same big O notation complexity for the sieve of Eratosthenes. An example of divide and conquer, first of all, divide and conquer is basically recursion, really, that in order to find a solution for a larger problem, you have to find the solution of smaller problems and then combine them to find the solution of the entire problem. Unlike dynamic programming, it doesn't require that the subproblems overlap. So you don't need to save also the results for methods that you already computed. So basically, to recognize divide and conquer is any recursion that doesn't have overlap. A subproblem like the original problem, but with a smaller size, is basically an example of dividing and recursion. Now, in order to show you this algorithm, I will take another standard algorithm in algorithms called find the closest pair of points in a Cartesian plane. So you are given a set of points in a 2D plane. It doesn't have to be 2D, but 2D is the simplest version that we can think of. It's easier for us. So you are getting a matrix of points, like all of these points in a 2D. And you want to find the closest pair. Like basically, if you have the distance from every point to every point, the ones that are the closest to each other. Now, if the brute force algorithm is that you take every point and all of the distances to all of the other points, and then you take the next point, all of the distances to all of the other points, and then you compute the minimum. And the number of first values that you computed is n square, because you have any two combination of two points. And basically the minimum is much smaller than n square. So I will basically compute incrementally and maintain the minimum at every step. So it's a quadratic algorithm, the brute force. Divide and conquer, that we'll discuss about next, it divides the problem into subproblems and quite smartly. First, it sorts all of the points in increasing order of the x coordinate. So all of these points have an x coordinate, and I sort them. Basically, I know which point is most left, which point is next left, and so on up to the rightmost point. Then I divide this, I get a sorted list S, and I divide it in two equal subsets, S1 and S2, with the midpoint in the middle. And the midpoint, I can put it in S1 or S2. Recursively, I find in the same way that we'll describe below, the closest pair in S1 and the closest pair in S2, and the distances between those closest pairs, D1 and D2. D will be the minimum of the two distances. Then I find the closest pair point between, I found the closest pairs in S1 and S2. And now I basically can, I have to find the closest pair if it's possible in the middle between a point in S1 and the point in S2. And the way that I do it is the following. I don't look at other points that are further away than D, the minimum of the closest distance, the minimum between the closest distance in S1 and S2. So I basically only construct a strip of the points that are at most from that middle point, D of X coordinate minus D or plus D, okay? Now, not only that, instead of computing between every point in the strip L and every point in the strip R, the closest, the distance, I also divide on the vertical, on the y-axis, by distance d. So now when I compare points in S1 with points in S2, I compare them only in adjacent, neighbored squares out of those d's that I computed before. So I don't have to look at every point in strip R for a point P. I basically look for points that are in one of the neighboring locations, okay? So basically I divide also the vertical point. So for any point in S1, I basically am looking for points in S2 with X coordinate minus D and X coordinate plus D and compute their distance D3, okay? So the first step of sorting the points by X coordinate is n log n. And that can be done in basically n log n time. It's just sorting. The step, the third step of basically finding the points in the middle with the shortest distance is also O of n. And I will show you how. If D is the minimum between D1 and D2, for a point in S1 and a point of S2 to be a closest pair, S1, the point in S1 must be in strip L and the point in S2 must be in strip R. So for every point in the points ordered by Y, I order them by Y in the middle. If P is in S1 and middle of X minus P of X is less than D, the distance, the minimum distance, then I append the point to strip L and append the point to strip R. This is done in O n time. Then for each point in strip L, I iterate through the strip R, and for every R starting from zero with index less than strip R length, and the coordinate Y of the point in strip R is less than P of Y minus D, I basically, what I'm doing is that for any point P, I'm dividing these and I'm only looking at those that are within the distance D in the Y coordinate. So instead of looking at the entire strip R, I only look at most plus D and minus D of the Y of the point P. So while and then I basically compute the distance between the point P and those neighbors. If the distance D is less, is greater than the distance between P and Q of R1, then I keep that and there's a new distance that is the minimum. So what's the complexity of this algorithm? T of N is 2 times T of N minus 2. So basically I have to compute the minimum in both sides, plus the time to compute the minimum between the slides in the middle, which is at most N, because I do in constant time for every point, I can look at those points that are within plus D and minus D of the Y distance. So that in total, this is a recurrence relation that stands for n log n. And the entire program is in the lecture notes. And I have a version that I will put on Piazza after the class, which generates random points and finds the shortest distance and the pair that has that shortest distance. Let me also do backtracking. So next class, we can go further to sorting. So the eight queens problem. So the eight queens problem, given a chessboard of 8x8, I want to find the positions for the queens, each queen, such that no two queens attack each other, either on the horizontal, the vertical, or the diagonal. So how does the n queens problem works? Basically, first I need a representation for the n queens. And I create an array queens of eight elements. I assign j to a queen of I, denoting that there is a queen at row number I and column j. So that's the representation that I want in the end. Initially, I just create an array. And if you're thinking queens of I as basically the default value is that all of the queens are in the first column, but really we are looking at one queen at a time. So the search starts with k equals zero. So k is the current row number. And basically I have to look at all of the previous rows from zero to k, check the queen for every queen on one of those previous rows. I have to check if it's on the same value or if it's the lower diagonal, the major diagonal or the minor diagonal. And there are formulas for all of those. Basically, the absolute difference between X and Y, if it's the same, then it's on one of the diagonals. And then I continue with the next queen. If I'm successful, I continue to place the next queen in the next row. If I basically reach the last row, I found a solution. If I cannot, the current position of the current queen, it's not good, it backtracks to the previous row and continues the search for a new placement in the next column of the previous row. So this algorithm will backtrack in essence even to the first row if it cannot find the placement for the queens in the following rows. And this is called backtracking. So let me show you an example. So basically, initially I start by calling n queens, and the class n queens creates an object. Search will start searching for the queen. I start with row number zero. As long as the row is greater than zero and the k is less than the size, I have to find the position to the current queen k. So find position for k is a function that basically returns the next possible position for the queen k. So I basically, here is the implementation. I start with the queen plus one as the start new placement position, the previous version of value of k. And then for every previous from start to the current to size, I'm checking if it's valid that position kj. Now is valid looks at the previous queen. So it has a for loop from one to the current row. If the if is the same column, so the value of queens of row minus I is equal with the same, the current column, then it's not a good placed queen. If the difference, if the queens of row minus I is the difference of column minus I, then is the left diagonal. And if the queens of row minus I is equal with the column plus I, then is the upright diagonal. In either case, I'm returning false. That means that there is a conflict, which basically will iterate to the next value. And I will try the next position of the queen. If I'm reaching the size, then I return minus one. And now is the interesting part. So if the value of j is less than zero, the position of the queen k is reset to minus one, and I'm backtracking to the previous queen. So this line here basically does the backtracking. And now everything runs the same way. So I basically now iterate in the while loop and I check again if the k is less than size. I continue to find the position for the queen in row k from the current position, because queens of k already contain the current position of the queen k. Convex hull is another standard problem in computer science. So the way that I learned convex hull is that you are given a set of points in the Cartesian plane, like nails on that you basically put in a piece of wood. If you not take an elastic around it and you leave it, it will find the smallest convex polygon that basically contains all of the points interior in the interior. So the queen is essentially a depth first search, but you have to backtracking because you prune everything under it, but then you backtrack to the previous queen, because if you didn't find a position for the current queen up to the end of the row. So you are completely right, Theo. Okay, so let's return to the convex hull. So if you take an elastic, you have nails in a table, and you take an elastic, large elastic, and you leave it, it will basically find the smallest convex polygon that contains all of the points inside. There are other ways to think intuitively about this. What is the biggest polygon that can be built out of the points that I have? Then the nails that I have in the table, those points that I have. So this is an example of a convex polygon that contains all of the points, is the convex hull of this, basically of these points. And this is not a convex hull because it's not a convex. Basically I can choose two points inside that polygon. And if I draw a segment between them, there are points on that segment that are outside that polygon. And convex hull has a lot of applications in pattern recognition, usually in image processing, game programming, and so on. Okay. And there are many algorithms that I want to discuss today about for this. And the first algorithm is called the gift wrapping algorithm. So H is initially empty. That's the convex hull that I want to compute. So given a set of points S, we let the points in S to be labeled S0 to SK, select the rightmost lowest point. So basically you can sort them by the Y coordinate and sort them by the X coordinate. First, for those that have the same Y coordinate, you take the minimum, you find the minimum Y, and then you take the maximum X, and that finds, you find the lowest right point in rightmost lowest point in the number of points, and you add it to the convex hull. Now you let T0 be H of 0, that point that you found. That point must be in the convex hull because it's rightmost lowest, so there is no way that it's not inside. Let T1 be any point that you haven't seen yet. You can choose this T1, or you can choose this, or this, or this, and so on. For every point P in S, if P is to the right of, by computing the angle between T0 and T1, of the direct line between T0 and T1, then let T1 be P. So you choose a random point, let's say for instance this point, then you look at another point, any other one other point, and if it's to the right of that segment that you draw, you basically move that T1 to the new point. And you continue like this until you find the next point on the convex hull. So after you basically iterate over all the points, the T1 will be on the convex hull. You assign T1 to T0, and you continue the algorithm. Now, given a point, 2 points, and a third point, so P0, P1, and P2, you can always, there is an arithmetical formula, which is right here, that you can say if P2 is to the right of, on the line, or to the left of a segment. So really, in constant time, given the next point, you can tell me if I have to move P1 to P2 or not. So we started with T1 being h of 0. And basically, if T1 is h of 0, then you are done. You found the convex hull. Otherwise, you basically let T0 be T1. So you assign T1 to T0, and you go back to step 2. And again, you start iterating through all of the other points. And for every point, you can find out if it's the next one on the line or not. And this is a correct algorithm. You can intuitively see that it will go around and find the convex hull. Finding the rightmost lower point, given basically just a minimum algorithm, is O of n. Checking whether a point is to the side of a line, to the left-hand side of a line, is O of 1. And because we are repeating h times this algorithm, is h the time to basically compute the convex hull, and at every time you execute n steps, because you basically start with all of the points to find if they are rightmost with basically one element at a time. In the worst case, you basically take h multiplied with n times. So the number of points on the convex hull multiplied with n points that we basically wanted to compute the convex hull for. There is a better algorithm for this. It's called the Graham algorithm. He died recently at 85 in August this year, in 2020. He was a co-author of Paul Erdős. He was a very cool guy. If you are interested, I learned to juggle because I wanted to be as cool as him. He is very good at algorithms. He was very good at algorithms. And the algorithm is as follows. Given the set S of points, find the rightmost lowest point P0. Same algorithm that we started with before. Then for all of the other points that you have, sort them by angle. So basically you can compute the angle with respect to the x-axis for every other point. And you sort them by angle, all of the other points. Basically, now you can sort by angle, let's say P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, and so on. So now you have the point P0, which was the beginning of the convex hull, and all of the other points sorted by minimum angle to maximum angle. If there is a tie, that basically means that two points are on the same angle, then discard the one that is closest to P. So this is this example that you see here. I had it here. So if you find two points that are on the same angle, you can eliminate this point because the convex hull will contain it. So discard the one that is closest to P of P, the previous P. So now the points are sorted, P0, and then all of the other points based on the angle. Now, we will want actually a stack. Push P0, P1, and P2 on a stack. So those are the minimum numbers, like P0, let's say P1, and P2. Then in a while loop, as long as I is less than n, let T1 and T2 be the first two elements on the stack. Pi is on the left of a direct line from T2. If Pi is on the left line, basically if we have either this case or this case. So if Pi is on the left-hand side of a direct line from T2 to T1, then you push Pi to the convex hull and you increment with 1. So as I have this angle points if this pi is basically, if it makes with another point, look at p3 here, if p2 is basically below the line of p1 to p3, then don't put it on the convex hull. If for the next number, like p3, p2 is to the left-hand side of p1 and p3, then put it on the convex hull. And you only have to iterate once over all of the points. The points that you will get in H at the end are the convex hull. Now, the way that this algorithm executes, and I will just go directly to the complexity, is that the step number 2 can be executed in log linear time, n log n. Step number 4, finally collecting the points on the convex hull, is O of n. Therefore, the algorithm is log linear time. I saw some questions in the chat. Yes, learning how to juggle is not a required feature of this class. Okay, thank you. Okay, so just some practical considerations of complexity. The big O notation is the best way that we can compare efficiency of algorithms. However, two algorithms of the same time complexity are not necessarily equally efficient. If you compare 100n with n divided by 2, they both have O of n, but 100n is a much worse algorithm than n divided by 2. So although they have the same O notation. So it's something that we learn, but we'll have to consider practically, does this algorithm make sense or not? And that's the end of the lecture today. Let's stop sharing and let's stop recording.